Hi Manish, Sharad here from FIS. One of my colleagues did not get the invite, though she registered. Is it something I can directly add her to the meeting or?
Yes, he can. Forward your invitation to them.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. I hope my screen is properly visible to all and my voice is clear to everyone, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, so thank you so much for joining. So myself, Rupesh, I'm the digital strategist working with Synergetics. Welcomes you all for the today's webinar on the complete guide to Microsoft Power Platform. So we'll before going ahead with the session, just a moment. So today's workshop is organized by ETC community and sponsored by Synergetics. So ETC community is open for all the people who are interested in the emerging technology and Microsoft cloud technologies. You just need to follow up our meetup groups, which are as follows. So the group names are Emerging Technology Community, Azure Tech Community Pune, Azure Tech Community Nagpur, Azure Tech Community Surat, and AI on Microsoft Platform Community. There's another community that we have recently started, which is specially for L&D professionals, learning and development professionals. So if you belong to the profession like learning managers, training managers, CIOs, CTOs, project managers, then you can just follow this community. All you have to do is just have to install a meetup application in your phone and you can follow a community just by searching the names, or you can do it by scanning this QR codes. Okay. So this is a small code of conduct for today's session. Please note that you cannot take a screenshot of this presentation and you cannot do the screen recording. So the recording will be shared at the end of the session on the YouTube channel. For that, you have to just follow YouTube channel. I'll be sharing the YouTube channel link in the chat box. Please do follow that. So you'll be updated about the latest videos that have been uploaded over YouTube. So today's session is all about the complete guide of MS Power Platform. In this session, we are going to explore Power components. And this is the agenda and takeaways for today's session. So today's speaker for workshop is Mr. Om Prakash Pandey. Om Prakash comes with decades of rich experience in technical learning and implementation consultation across India and the globe. He has successfully provided architectural construction consultation on gamut of emerging technologies. His teaching experience spans across more than 50,000 students across more than 200 expertise across the world. His specialties includes concept visuals and simple example of complex technologies and offering technology solutions that help organizations to achieve their business goals. Currently, he is involved in the offering innovative architectural and learning solution using cloud resources, including containerization, Microsoft Azure infrastructure solution, SharePoint Architect, and SAP on Azure. So this is a course calendar for the month. Currently, we are giving all the trainings at 50% flat off, 50% flat discount. And here you will be getting a training plus Microsoft official curriculum, that is MOC, along with the vouchers, exam vouchers. So anyone who is interested to opt for the training, they can contact me. The contact number will be shared in the chat box. So this is our upcoming webinar calendar. I want to make this special announcement that on the coming weekend, the next weekend, we'll be having two webinars. So one is of emerging technology and the other is a certification, as you can see. So the topic for emerging technology webinar is migration to .NET Core and classic .NET application to .NET 5. And the second session will be a DP 100 certification. So who are interested, they can register for this webinars. We'll be sharing the registration link in the chat box. One special announcement. Firstly, your feedbacks are important to us, so please don't forget to submit the feedbacks. And based on those feedbacks that we'll received, we are going to pick five nominees, and we will be giving them the exam vouchers, Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers. Okay. So now I would like to hand over mic to Om Prakash sir. Thank you everyone once again. So you can proceed.
Thank you very much, Rupesh. Good morning and warm welcome to everyone. I hope I'm audible to you all.
Yes, you are. Yes. Good morning, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good morning. Let me know once my screen is visible.
Yeah, it is now.
So welcome to complete guide on Microsoft Power Platform. I know this title is a bit surprising. Power Platform being a wide platform and a lot of services within that, how are we going to cover that in 2 hours? I know that. So the focus here is not completing everything to the required depth, but to getting you introduced to what are the areas within Power Platform, starting from learning, understanding, implementation, and getting certified. So complete set of guidance I will provide over here to make sure everybody gets aligned to it. And going ahead, understands the roadmap of what Microsoft is planning and implementing as part of this environment. So without wasting any more time, let me jump onto this area. Rupesh has already introduced me, so I am not repeating that part over here. I'm sorry, guys, I don't have too much time where I can connect to each of you all one-on-one. But quickly taking a poll from all of you all, how many of you have already worked with Power Platform? Can you raise your hands? People who have worked with Power Platform earlier, can you raise your hands? Okay. So I can see few of the hands raised. Thank you very much, guys. Please put your hands down. How many of you all have already worked with Microsoft 365? Can you raise your hands? Microsoft 365. Super. So there are plenty of them who have worked with Microsoft 365. So that's the right audience which I have over here. Great. Everyone, please put your hands down. Everyone, please put your hands down. How many of you are new to Office 365? Can you all raise your hands? New to Office 365? New to Microsoft 365 platform? Okay. I see plenty of people over there as well. But this number is slightly higher as compared to people who are experienced. Not an issue, guys. So people who are new to Microsoft 365, new to Office 365, I'm sorry, I will not be covering details of Office 365 in this session because the target area is moving ahead with Power Platform, right? So you'll have to do some of the read up over here on what is Office 365 all about, what is Microsoft 365 platform, and what is the difference between those members. just to quickly get you all onboarded. As far as Office 365 is concerned, Office 365 is series of services for end users, right? So you all must have used set of tools like set of services like SharePoint Online, Microsoft Teams that you are already working with right now, connected through that you are connected to me or and my team. Along with that, you all must have used your email services using Exchange Online, right? All these are part of your Office 365 platform. Along with this, Microsoft 365 adds additional resources in terms of security, advanced threat protection, right? Security and compliance requirement, security and compliance center. These are the components as part of your Microsoft 365, right? Now, getting on to Microsoft Power Platform. As part of your Microsoft Power Platform, this is a new era implementations for number of users who are referred as power users. Now, what is the meaning of power? Now, whenever I deal with these kind of sessions, many people ask me in terms of Om Prakash, when you say power users, what do you mean by that? Because we have never heard about such a term. We have heard about developers, we have heard about architects, we have heard about operations engineer. Manish and team is already providing contents for each of these roles on the Synergetics portal, so y'all can go and check that, right? But we have heard about number of roles. What when you say power users, what is this role all about? And who are these people? How are they different from other roles that you have? As part of your power users are concerned, are they end users? Okay, one more, I would not say it's a role. One more member that you'll see is your end users. So when you say power users, are they end users? The answer is no. As far as power users are concerned, they are neither developers, nor architects, nor operations engineers, neither they are hardcore end users. As far as power users are concerned, these are basically business analysts who understand domain. So they have a decent amount of domain knowledge. They are not developers, so they may not have a lot of development knowledge in their past, right? As far as they are not deep dive architects, so they would not know end-to-end solution, how it gets created, what happens over here, but they know what is the end user expectation. This is what they are aware about. Right? This is what they are aware about. What they can help people, organization do is create a quick POC, proof of concept, how these things will work, right? What will be the resources over here? Now, roadmap, right? I am not sure how many of you are aware about this term. Many architectural practices, we have something called as RAD, Rapid Application Development. Right? This is what is the core scenario or focus area for power users. So they should be doing the business, they should have a domain knowledge, they need not be having a lot of developer experience, which means as part of power users, if we need to provide them solutions, it has to be a no code solution, right? Or the solutions can be developed by using small formulas over here, like you have in Excel or any sources, right? As far as expectations are concerned, they can quickly create this POC, rapid application development, to capture the user details. Now, keeping this context in mind, let's now proceed ahead with the components within Power Platform. Now, this context was important because if there are certain set of audiences who would have expectations in terms of how do I get into these environments, how do I start creating resources, I am not a great developer, I'm not thorough with my Java knowledge or .NET knowledge or Node.js kind of applications, don't worry. Right? Even if you have that knowledge, it may not get to the fullest use over here. But you, if you have the logical bent of mind, you understand the business correctly, this is the right session for you and this is the right forum for you. As part of this member, I'm going to discuss about what is Microsoft Power Platform, right? What are the options for data connectors over here, right? Getting all these members together to make sure we build an end-to-end scenario, how that is possible, right? We can look at getting started with Power Apps quickly. I'm not sure how much time I can devote to that, right? And quickly wrap up with a summary over here, showcasing what are the certification options here, what are the documentations available, what are resources shared by Microsoft, and what is the role that Synergetics can play in upbringing your knowledge in terms of our platform. Okay, so keeping that context in mind, let's proceed further. As far as this Power Platform, as far as your applications are concerned, your applications that you use or applications which have been built are broken up into different set of components, right? So one of the core components that everybody would have interacted with or you would have used and known is the front-end UI. So if you go to a website or if you open up your mobile phone, within your mobile phone, what you have is a front-end, right? Created by using some complex technology like Angular or React or Android app development, right? J2ME kind of applications, right? There are a number of options for it. Now, if I'm not a developer, how do I create such kind of beautiful, responsive UI which changes as per the form factor? That's where you have your Power Apps, which helps you build a front-end UI for end-user communication. Along with this, the next resource that you'll want to use over here, once I have entered those values, what next? Should it go to a database and get stored over there? Should it go and connect to another service, get me authenticated, and as per my authorization, I will be able to access some of these resources? I'm sorry, guys, I'm throwing some of the technical terms over here, but these terms are essential for you to understand the significance of Power Platform. So the first interaction happens with Power Apps. Behind the scene, you have a complete workflow. Now this workflow will be created by using something called as Power Automate, which initiates the process over here. Every organization, as you all know, is built using processes, and people are working with those processes to achieve the business outcomes. Correct? So to initiate those processes, to trigger those processes, you have your Power App. Now, once Power App gives you the required UI and you have keyed in the data over here, it will go back, trigger this workflow, which is a Power Automate workflow. It will execute all the steps which is required behind the scene, update necessary set of resources, get you the required data that you would want, right? Now, while you are communicating with your web applications, one approach would be using a simple GUI format. There would be second set of communications which you would want to do by using something called as bots, right? So normal communication, you can do it through Power Apps, trigger a Power Automate, or if you want to create a chatbot quickly, you can create a chatbot by using a Power Virtual Agent, right? I don't have to explain you all what are chatbots, because everybody would have gone to number of websites. You all would have seen how, if you look at a banking website or any other website for that matter, right? Number of websites, they have one of the communication options today as intelligent chatbots, right? Where you can initiate communication, where you can ask your relevant questions and get the respective answers for it. Okay. Anyone, any question?
आराध्य आवाज कमी कर मैं बंद करना किन्हीं उड़न
एवरीवन प्लीज कीप योरसेल्फ ऑन म्यूट अमोल कैन यू टर्न ऑफ योर वीडियो थैंक यू या लेट्स प्रोसीड फर्दर गाइस हैपेंस एट टाइम्स सो आई वाज मेंशनिंग अबाउट पावर एप्स पावर ऑटोमेट चैटबॉट सॉरी चैटबॉट बेस्ड इंटीग्रेशन यूजिंग Power virtual agents. Now, once you have collated all these information, once you have collected all these information coming from the user, you may want to showcase them as reports, showcase them as in terms of business analytics. Now, it is not essential that everything which is being showed in the report using Power BI is coming from the user itself. Some of these things could be historical information as well. Some of these things could be the prior data that we have collected. So those reporting has to be, will can be done or will be done by using your Power BI, which is a very, very elegant UI data analytics or business analytics reporting tool, right? So though I have discussed all these four components as part of a integration or part of a scenario over here, right, which you can do, absolutely no doubt on that. Along with this, you can also use each of these members independently. Say, for example, I want to use a chatbot solution. I already have my website, which is using, say, HTML5 or any other resource. On that, I want to associate a Power Virtual Agent. I can do that. I have a Power App, and within this Power App, I want to capture the information, save it inside Microsoft Forms, save it inside Microsoft Forms, save it inside SharePoint, SQL Server database without using Power Automate. I can do that as well, right? So there is no hard and fast saying that all these four components have to work together. Like in terms of Office 365, are you forced to use all the 36 or 37 services that we have? We are not. Similarly, these suite of products can be used in combination to solve a business problem, or they can, you can use one of these components depending upon your requirement. Apart from these forefront services that you have, there are backend resources as well, which helps you to achieve your business objectives. So in terms of the UI, as the UI keeps growing complex, you can go ahead, create something called as Power App Portal. Okay, you can go ahead, create Power App Portal over here. Along with this, when we were mentioning about pushing data into SQL Server, pushing data into SharePoint, pushing data into other online service that you have, how will that happen? That magic is being performed by Data Connector, which helps you to authenticate with that service, right? And based on the permissions that you have, it will allow you to push data or insert, update, delete, perform those kind of operations on the backend data source. In today's context, so where you have a series of services given by Microsoft, where we have artificial intelligence enabled services by using custom vision API, language understanding services, right? Luis API, right? Then you have your scanner based application, right, where you can scan a particular image. Where you can scan a particular image and work with it, right? So there are a number of such requirements that an organization would have. Okay, now whenever we hear about such kind of requirements, we get chattered saying, boss, this is not my cup of tea. I will need to hire a developer, hire a consultant from outside, because they are the ones who are specialized in that area. Right? Believe me, guys, Microsoft has made these things very, very simple, very, very effective for us by using something called as AI Builder. So using this AI Builder, you can get whatever cognitive services I was mentioning about, whether it is Luis or custom API, with minimum, yes, I would not say you don't have to train that model. Somebody else will train that model for you, but you can utilize those models over here via your AI builder solutions. Okay. So now this AI, before I forget about it, data connectors will be working with Power BI, Power Apps, Power Automate, right? AI builder similarly will be working with each of those components that you can see at the top. So these form a foundation for these services, right? These portals or data connector, AI builder, these form a foundation for these services. So the background part of the processing is taken care by these members. Now, when you are working with these resources, you have something for data, correct? Now, like I told a minute ago, that Power BI can help you with working with a lot of historical information. Now, when I say historical information, where is this information coming from? This information may be coming from your data lake services, which is on Azure, SQL database, SharePoint, Excel, right? Some of the third-party data services. So all this data is coming from different set of sources. So how do I assimilate all this data, convert them into a user understandable format, and then generate a report out of it? Now all that data storage and the data processing is taken care by Dataverse. The older name was Common Data Service. Now it is called as Dataverse. Dataverse basically means universe of data. So this is a new name that Microsoft has given. And if I'm not mistaken, this has happened 2 weeks ago. Correct? So don't get lost with the terms over here. As the technology is evolving, Microsoft is also giving appropriate names to that. Say, for example, Power or
Om Prakash?
Yes, Nikhil?
Can you please pardon, what was the name of the thing that you told us?
Dataverse.
Dataverse. Can you type it in chat box?
And Om Prakash, I had a question.
Just one moment. This is called as universe of data. Data coming from number of data sources. I'll come to the questions a bit later. Just pardon me for that. Just give me some time. Let me complete this because we have shortage on time. So last half an hour, I'll keep specifically for questions. And possible is by that time, your questions might have get answered. Extremely sorry for that. It's only because of shortage on time.
Oh, sure. Thank you. And I understand.
Yeah. So the older, what I was saying is Common Data Service. The new name is Dataverse. Similarly, in case of Power Automate, the older name was Microsoft Flow. So some of these technologies may not be entirely new. They have been there earlier, but it was having a different name to it. Now Microsoft is coming up with those services or putting those services as a new component or a new environment. Let me quickly go through each of these areas. Like I mentioned, once it comes to Power Apps, this is role-based solution where depending upon who's the user, what tasks they want to perform with this environment, they can create a canvas-based app over here, right? So here you can have data-driven application where you can use data models. You can associate with business processes. See, I have been mentioning about this term business processes time and again. Now, one key member, which I should not forget, once it comes to business processes, here you have something called as Dynamics 365. So you can easily integrate your entire Power Platform with Dynamics 365. As far as these Power Apps UI is concerned, this Power Apps UI, like I said, is responsive to different set of form factors, whether it is web applications, mobile applications, laptops, desktops, right? So these are by default responsive to any kind of UI. If you want to modify that UI or change that UI, it's up to you. You can do that as well. So you can specify your resources, specify the details over here. You can make that change. Another member. So while I'm going through each of these services, I would also want you all to.
Sorry, Om Prakash. Is it responsive or is it adaptive? I mean, are there any new releases came in which wherein Power Apps became responsive?
Mm-hmm. When you say responsive UI, what I mentioned already is it is adaptable to number of form factors that you have.
Okay.
And both of them, as per my understanding, is the same. So depending upon the change in terms of the form factor, it will reorganize or readjust itself as per that environment.
Okay.
So if you look at your React environment or Angular environment, it gives you a single form application, SPA based application, which can adapt to any of the frameworks, any of the form factors that you have.
Fine, Om Prakash. Actually, they are different, but yeah, I understood.
Okay, thanks a lot. So here, if you see, this is your Office 365 environment. I have currently, for this particular demo, I have taken up a environment over here. Now, using this environment, you'll see there are number of services that you have over here. As part of your services, you have Power Automate, Power BI, Power Apps as key services over here, right? There are a lot of other services as well. So once you look at Power Platform can integrate with these services as well. But we don't put it under the same suit or the same environment as Power Platform. But these are independent services within Office 365. I was mentioning about Power Apps. So as far as Power Apps is concerned, this is your Power Apps environment. As part of Power Apps environment, you have different set of resources over here readily available. In terms of apps that you'd want to create, there are pre-existing sample apps over here where you can start with. So depending upon which of these apps solves your problem or is closer to your application requirements, you can make use of it. Currently, what I have done is I have created an environment over here. And from that, I'm getting number of entities which could be relevant for my requirement. And all these entities that you see, the tables, the choices that you see, these are part of your Dataverse. All this is part of the Dataverse environment. Right? So integration with your data flows, similar to your Azure Data Factory, your Synapse-based integration, all this is possible with Dataverse. So where do you want to pull this data from? What are the sources available? You can get this from here. Right? Can you see this? Azure Synapse linked to Dataverse. In terms of connections, which I was mentioning about, there are a lot of pre-built connections over here. And if you want, you can.
Sorry to interject. So the data will be stored within Azure storage and we'll just connect from here. That's what it
is. Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. That's why it is referred as a link. Because once it comes to your Power Platform, this is more like an end user or a power user environment. You don't have large amount of data storage available here. So our colleague very rightly mentioned that it has a very good integration with Azure platform as well. So as far as this information is concerned, Azure Synapse information, this is the data is actually stored within the Azure Synapse and gets connected over here within our platform. From your on-premises connectivity perspective, you can pull data from your on-premises environment as well by installing a gateway. So we are looking at three members over here. From a cloud perspective, you see, we are looking at number of options available, which is infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and these are part of Microsoft Azure. If you look at SaaS solutions, we are looking at Office 365. We are looking at Microsoft 365 solutions, right? And from a power user's perspective, we are looking at our Power Platform here. So it integrates all these options that we have. IaaS services, PaaS services, and also SaaS services. All these things under one platform. Okay. Along with this, I was mentioning about the AI builder. From AI builder perspective, you already have set of options over here. From entity extraction, form processing that you have. And these are set of key members which are available to you. Doing a sentiment analysis of the text being stored, scanning a text from an image or a PDF that you have, that is text recognition, your receipt processing. Now, believe me, guys, some of these things, when I started working with cognitive services as part of the Azure platform, it seemed to me as a very, very Herculean task. And I have done these things using .NET code as well, Java code as well, invoked them as services, right? It's a very, very complex task over there. I have to learn set of APIs for it. But the moment I saw how Microsoft is integrating this over here, right, it is really, really easy for every user, every power user, to get the advantage of artificial intelligence inside your simple platform that you would have, right? Your category classification, business card reading, all. I'm not saying it will give you 100% of your solutions, but day-to-day usage solutions, you'll get it from here. If your questions are not being answered here by the components being given, not to worry, you can go ahead, build your own model over here. I have a different kind of business requirement. I want to create I want to use something like Q&A Maker, which is having questions relevant to my team members, my end users. You can create your own model here. Train that model. You need to train that model by giving right set of inputs, right set of data, and then you can start using them within your Power Apps. Okay, so there's a complete set of details that you have over here. And like I said earlier, as part of Synergetics, this is our role to make sure we equip people in performing these kind of customizations using set of pre-existing member, and if need be, customizing them as per their end user requirement. Right? From learning perspective, we can help you with that. I'm sure people are busy with a lot of other things. Office work will also be there, so we can break it up into smaller chunks and learn it, right? You can also refer to a lot of online material which is available, right? So even that is what can help you get started with this platform. So this was a quick look in terms of Power Apps. One more thing which I would want to showcase over here is the environment for Power Apps, which is learningplatformdocs.microsoft.com. Here you'll see complete guidance in terms of what is Power Platform and especially what is Power Apps all about. Right? So some of these applications, sample solutions, you'll be able to see over here, which can help you get started with Power Apps. Further to the next member here. I will be able to take one or two questions. So I'm not sure if somebody had a question. Let me take that.
Yeah, the question that I had was, for using any of the Azure data services, okay, so when I am, suppose I am misconnecting them with from my Power app. Okay.
Okay.
So the license, what license would I require for this for using my Power app so that I can pull any of the Azure data services?
Mm-hmm. As far as Azure connectivity is concerned, it is nothing to do with the license that you have. In sense, even if you have a free tier license, you can connect to Azure services. But if you want to use maximum resources of your environment, I would recommend you go for a E3 license of Office 365, which can help you use all the components of Office 365 plus components of your Power apps or our environment.
So it's E3 you said, right?
Sorry, I didn't get it. Can you repeat the question?
So it's E3 you said, right? E3 license you said.
E3 license, yes. People who are not asking questions, please keep your
Hi, Ashutosh, this side. Is changing data source will impact our performance or app? Data source here means like if you are using CDS or SharePoint online or on-premise. Will their app performance will get impacted?
You are asking me, you are telling me?
Asking me. Asking you, sorry.
Okay. So if you look at your data source, how much time does it take to connect to the data source? That will definitely impact the performance. So if you have your data within your on-premises environment, so going from your online service to your gateway, then connecting to your on-premises server, that will obviously take time, as compared to data being available onto another cloud environment.
Yeah.
So, and by what ways can we minimize this time, I mean, if there is a latency?
I think Ashutosh already answered that question. So if you have the schema as part of your Dataverse, right? So you have the data, your schema locally stored, and then you can pull whichever data you want using the respective queries. And you can use something like OData queries over here, so that you fetch only the relevant information that you have. So many such best practices we can discuss as part of our sessions, which I will not be able to complete the discussion today. Let's proceed further with the next one.
This is Ashok. Regarding the OData query, we are habitual to SQL queries like TSQL. Is it difficult to learn OData query, or how is
absolutely
it?
No. If you know what is web environment or your simple web request, get request, post request you have handled, so these OData queries will be easier for you to work with.
Yes.
And there's a specific syntax. I don't think it will take too much time, especially people who are coming from a SQL background. So once you understand, how do you write select queries in SQL vis-a-vis what is the mapping for OData queries? So it will take not more than 2 days to, I would say, maximum of 2 days to learn that.
Yes, thank you. And one more question. What is the difference between connections and connectors?
Very good. As far as connectors are concerned, connectors are the one which are pre-existing resources over here, which are for data connectors. How many instances of that connector you have used? Say, for example, I have a SQL connector. If I'm connecting to database one, I'll have one connection there. If I'm connecting to database two or server two, server three, for each servers, I'll have a different connection. Are you getting it?
No. I think like from where the servers will come into picture in case of IaaS.
Or on-premise services that you have?
Yes. Okay, for on-premises connection with the on-premises things, connections will come into picture. And databases, like online databases, connectors will come into picture.
No, you absolutely understood incorrectly. I will repeat myself. I have, say, on my service, I have Outlook account, right?
Yes.
You have four email addresses, one for Gmail, one for Hotmail, one for your organization account. For Outlook as a connector, there's one Outlook connector. But for three different emails, you'll require three different connections. One connection will not work.
Yes.
Got it?
Yes. Thank you.
So the connector is same, but you have to configure it differently.
Okay. Okay, the multiple connectors can be inside one connector. Connector is on high level and connections is like granular level.
Yes, connection is basically one configuration for a given environment.
Yes.
What is the difference between Microsoft 365 and Office 365?
I'm sorry, I didn't get the question. Can you please repeat it?
Microsoft 365 versus Office 365.
I already mentioned that. I'll repeat it once again.
Yeah,
as far as Microsoft 365 is concerned, Microsoft 365 is Office 365 plus security resources. So your ATP, your compliance, security and compliance, all this is part of your security resources. Plus you have Windows 10 over here. This is all part of your Microsoft 365.
Okay.
Hello.
Thank you.
Okay.
You mentioned about the license.
Sorry, I will have to proceed further. I'll come to the license. I'm able to hear you, but I'm not able to answer you right now because I have a time constraint.
Okay.
I'll come to questions a bit later. Don't worry. Please park your questions for now. My apologies for it. I'll take up the questions once I'm completed with this. So moving ahead with the second important member over here, which is Power Automate. So once you look at your Power Automation over here, there are a number of other options that we have in context of automation, right? You have your Nintex workflows, you have Nintex workflows, SharePoint workflows, your BizTalk orchestration, you have WO2, right? You have number of ESB Mule, right? So there are different set of components over here which can help you with orchestration, which can help you with integration with number of services. And these are, and not just that, even logic apps for that matter will give you a very, very deep dive kind of details over here from integration perspective. So where does Power Automate stand over here? And what is the advantage that we get through Power Automate? If you look at your automation over here, right? The core purpose of Power Automate is, like I said earlier, create a POC, create a small environment over here, and all these components that we're talking about, these components are running in context of the user account. So which is the user who has connected to it right now? All these processes that we are creating will run in the context of the user, right? So whatever authentication rights that the user has, whatever authorization permissions the user has, keeping those kind of restrictions or keeping those kind of elements in mind, it will execute itself, right? So certain things that a user has been doing time and again, when a new email arrives, I want to do some kind of invoice processing, right? Using an if condition, I want to check for what is the values being given by the AI builder, right? Based on that, I can invoke an approval process, correct? If the values are beyond a certain limit, correct? Or else I can share that with the Dynamics team. Save the invoice details, insert a record into a database. So what is the business process I want to follow? All these steps can be clearly mentioned as part of the Power Automate steps. So ranging from simple scenarios, branching, loops, right? Whichever tasks that you want to that one would want to perform, all these things you can do over here. One of the important things that you can see is mechanism of triggering actions over here, granting approvals, multi-level approvals, parallel approvals. All these things can be done easily by using your Power Automate. Apart from working with your online environment, it is online services and integrating with them, even you can integrate with your on-premises resources like you have in Power Apps. Similarly, here also you have an option of using a gateway. So through this gateway, I can get details from the which is on your on-premises environment. Okay, So that's the core purpose, and that's how Power Automate can help you. Along with this, Power Automate has one more key resource over here, which is called as RPA, right? Robotics Process Automation. And for that, you have something called Power Automate Desktop. Now, using this Power Automate Desktop, you can run processes within your on-premises environment, on-premises application as well. Now, keeping this context in mind, let's go to the next member here, which is Power Automate. As part of Power Automate,
the Power Automate Desktop, which you said, does it comes with a license or is?
Sorry, I have muted somebody. I'll take up the questions later. Please give me some time. So here, what I mentioned about is set of processes over here. In terms of approval processes, there is a separate approval center over here. There's a separate approval center over here where you can initiate processes, get the, do the required approvals from here. In terms of flows that you see or the automation option that you see, you have your cloud flows, right? You have your automated cloud flows, your instant cloud flows, where you can trigger it by using a mobile device. There is another name for it, instant cloud flow, which is a button flow. So you can have respective buttons over here, and using those buttons, you can invoke these members over here, right? Then you have your scheduled cloud flows, and as the name suggests, you can, this can be triggered based on set of actions and activities that you have, right? So say certain things I want to execute every 1 hour, every week, once in a week, right? Once in an alternate day. So whatever set of actions and activities you have, all those things can be run on a specific schedule. Along with this, you have something called as desktop flows. This is what I was mentioning about. On this may not work for y'all right now. In my case, what I have done is I have already installed. In my case, I have already installed it over here. And this tool is referred as Power Automate Desktop. Just to give it a moment. Yeah, here it is. So if I go to new flow, click on create. It should launch another environment here where I can go ahead and make changes. And this is the one. So if you see the left hand side panel, you have your variables, conditions, loops that you would want to create. And all this is from RPA perspective, right? Working with OCR. So whatever resources you have on your on-premises environment, your terminal emulation, connecting to your Azure resources, working with cognitive services. So it's a complete platform that Microsoft gives you as part of your Power Automate Desktop. Similar set of resources you'll also see when you go for your online services. This is your online environment. This is your online environment we have, where you can go ahead and create your workflows. So there are two set of types of workflows, or like I showed you earlier. So you have your button workflows, Let me take up a blank one. Otherwise, I'll have to fill up all these values. So what is the name that you would want? Test flow online. What is the trigger that you want to create over here? So OneDrive for business, there is already a connector, but now I'll have to set up a connection. When I say set up a connection, which means I'll have to specify the user ID password over here. I'll have to specify which folder I want to connect to. This is what is mentioned as setting up a connection. Now, once you have done this, you'll see the options for AI Builder. You can invoke your desktop flow from here. You can use your MSN Weather, right? Any Dataverse implementation that you want to invoke from here. So all these are set of actions that you have, which are coming from the connector that you have imported, or connectors which are part of your environment. So depending upon the connection being established, you will have your authentication being done, and you will be able to perform those actions. If you have not done the connection, if you don't have the permissions, you even if you have the workflow created, it cannot execute because I don't have permissions on the OneDrive environment. Telling everyone. So these are set of resources. Now I think there was some question in terms of licensing. Let me answer that question. As far as each of these services are concerned, each of these services will have respective licensing options for itself. From whatever I am aware about, there is no direct licensing for Power Platform as yet. So for each of these services, say if I go for Power App license, so one question which I already answered, that if you go for any one of the existing resources, like your Office 365 E3 license, it already has the required license for it. Right? If you see this, Power Apps for Microsoft 365, using this license, you'll be able to access all the resources that you are looking for. And that's what I have done currently. So if I go to Power Platform Admins, if I go to Office 365 Admin Center, and if I go to the licensing over here, right? I already have a Power BI license, Power Virtual Agents trial license.
Om Prakash, can I ask a question here?
I have a Flow license over here. Right, so I already have set of licenses which is being done. You can also purchase a separate license for it. Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, what I've seen in past is like there are licenses per flow and per user actually.
License per flow, I don't think that's the right interpretation. License per user, yes, it is there.
License per Microsoft does has the concept of like they have per flow and per user, and what they do is like they charge you monthly in terms of flow, and that's something around $40 per flow, irrespective
of how aware of that.
Irrespective of how many times you run, and the, another is like a user, but you can run multiple flows multiple times and stuff. So they've got options on that. So the we guys have been implementing onto the users as a flow, not as I mean irrespective of the user license. So you buy for one, it's okay. Actually $20 I suppose, $20 per user per month, irrespective flow, but that's per user. And flow one was like $40 anybody can use, but it's per flow
possible.
It's there in the admin panel and only. You can go to the buy, so it will come as a per user $40.
Correct. That's right.
Correct.
One very important query, Prakash. Here. Now you are using suppose free license. then there is a limit for the data, actually 1 GB
absolutely
only.
Absolutely correct.
So
that's right.
Then how we can develop the more number of apps using the CDS of 1 GB?
I totally agree with you. As far as this free license is concerned, free license, I have never recommended you use it for production purposes. This is for learning and demo purposes. And that's what we are doing right now. Mm-hmm. So what you said very rightly, in terms of what will be the limits over here, once it comes to the free trial, depending upon which number of licenses that you are creating, right? The request limits are not based on the users or flows. So as far as the request is concerned, you can have any number of requests, but what you rightly said is, what is the number of data that you are passing over here? What is the amount of data that you want to store over here? That will depend upon your limits in terms of your license that you have purchased. Now this is a very important question, and I would like to take this question here. As far as CGTS is concerned, we are into learning, training, and consulting business. So as far as the license is concerned, license is taken care by the end users itself or the organization itself. So once they have purchased those licenses, and we are not into license selling. So I'm sorry, because I don't have knowledge on the licensing piece. So licensing, you'll have to connect to your Microsoft Spok. They will help you purchase these licenses. What we do is we go to the respective teams. We implement these things for them. We consult them on it. We train them on it and help them to get the best out of the license that they have purchased.
Makes sense. Om Prakash, one more question I have. As one of the things this power platform is actually getting up and up around, but I had a kind of an intelligence automation unit at one place. So the first question which has been asked is, like, we implemented UiPath from an RPA standpoint.
Yeah.
What is an incentive for us to actually move to this platform, other than that it's from Microsoft and integration and all those stuff? But the question what I was asking is, like, it's a cost to move. No matter it's a low code, no code kind of a stuff, but what's an incentive? Is it like costly, not costly? It does comes with one sticky nature of a cloud, which is always Azure. It doesn't gives you a hybrid cloud, right? And you can actually do it on a desktop basis also. But what's the benefit if I want to go back to my technology and I say, let's move it on from UiPath to Power Automate? What's the story?
I will not be able to answer that question because I have not worked with UiPath earlier.
Okay, if you can tell me what's the key feature for Power Automate to actually come towards Power Automate. See, there are multiple RPA platforms onto the in market right now. Automation Anywhere, UiPath, Power Automate being the new one. What's the incentive of coming over onto this one?
Okay, so like I said earlier, I have not worked with other RPA tools. But if you ask me in terms of Power Automate, what I find most interesting over here, or why as a business user I will buy it, I already have a license for it with me. But if I have purchased Office 365, I already have these licenses with me, especially in terms of E3 license. That's one. Second reason why I would want to go for this is, as far as my integration with other services are concerned, with Office 365, I get more than 27 to 30 services over here by default, which I don't think UiPath gives me or Automation Anywhere gives me.
Okay, so let me ask a question slightly differently, Om Prakash. All this UiPath and Automation Anywhere comes with the concept of orchestrator, where each robot can be actually optimized to the best of the possible, what you call, level, right? Let's say I'm running it at an enterprise level. I bought Flow. I bought RPAs. Like, in this, you take the license for RPA as a bot, basically, right? And there's a cost associated to it. The idea is to actually make them optimized, used. All bots are used optimized. Is that something comes out of the box here? I know from the UiPath, we have got something as an orchestrator client. Kind of stuff. Do we have an orchestrator which controls all the bots on the cloud?
Okay. Now, first of all, this don't run on cloud. This runs as a SaaS solution. What you are referring in terms of pods running on cloud, that is basically called as logic apps.
Okay.
As part of your Power Automate, all these things runs within your environment that we have created.
Okay.
As far as the performance is concerned or the tracking of these pods are concerned, yes, you can do.
Okay. Okay. So I understand. Great. Thanks.
Thank you everyone for the questions. I'll continue further. So second important resource that we had, which I mentioned about, is Power Automate. And similar to what I showcased earlier, you also have a complete learning path for it given by Microsoft, which you can capitalize on. As far as the pricing is concerned, you can see the pricing details over here. What are the options for each of them? So within each of these plans, what are the benefits that you get? My apologies for it. I'm not from a pricing background because we, Synergis as an organization, we don't sell licenses. We are more into consulting and training business. But I can share you the details based on what Microsoft has provided. And you all can take a decision, purchase respective tools, purchase for respective license from here, depending upon what is the data size that you want to store, right? What is the number of users that you have? How many flows you are wanting to create? Based on those parameters, you can go for these licenses. Let's go to the next section over here. So in terms of Power Automate, you have a complete documentation for this as well. So depending upon whichever operation you want to perform, whether it's looking at integration with your Azure DevOps using ALM, working with your data sources using Dataverse, you can work with that. I already mentioned about approval flows over here, right? Your desktop flows over here. You have a complete learning path given by Microsoft, where each and every member that you have, right? So whatever discussion that we were having, Microsoft has compared this with Win Automation, which was their older tool. So as compared to Win Automation, what is the advantages of using Power Automate? So they have given you this information as well on Microsoft Learning Path. Let's move further. So in terms of the next resource that you have is Power BI. As part of Power BI, what Microsoft has done already as part of SQL Server BI stack, they had set of services over here, which was part of SSRS, SSIS, and SSAS. The SSRS part, SQL Server Reporting Services, right? That component has been outsourced. That component has been created separately by using a Power BI service over here, right? As part of this Power BI service, we can quickly go ahead, create our data set, create our workspace over here, generate whatever reports you want relevant to the user. And once that part is being done, we can publish this or make it available to your end users, right? Or you can make it available to the people within your organization. So what set of permissions or how do you want these reports to be accessible? That's up to you. Along with your key resources that we're talking about from reporting perspective, you also can specify queries over here. Users are allowed to type their queries. And based on the queries being mentioned, it will use artificial intelligence behind the scene to understand the query, check for the properties and attributes behind the scene, and provide necessary response for it, right? Now, earlier what used to happen is whenever the report creators used to create these resources, it was going to the business users, it was going to the business decision makers, right? What they used to do is they used to come back with more set of feedback, right? Can you please add these values, modify these things, update these things, right? And many a times they would have an impression saying that how dumb this fellow is. Doesn't he understand, he or she understand the business well? Don't they understand what will be required, what will not be required? Now that was happening very, very to and fro. And that confusion was very, very obvious to happen, because the developers, the report creators, they were more from a developer background rather than from a business background. So what Microsoft did is, to solve that problem, they came up with Power BI, where end users can go and modify the parameters. End users can go and choose these values at runtime, right? And using that, they will be able to assess a specific, assess the business report from a specific perspective that they would want to. And that allows, these business owners to do something called a self-service BI. Right? So instead of going back and forth to a report developer, they can do a self-service BI. They can change some of these components themselves. But if they are looking for a specific type of control or specific type of UI which is not there, then they can go back to the developer saying, can you show it in a different format? Show the different charts that I want. So that charts can be created by the developers. And now you through that chart, they can specify appropriate value and they can see it over there. Right? So I'm not saying the development tasks have become zero, these guys have become irrelevant, but they are only required in case of customization. Generally, changing of data or filtering of data, right? All those things can be done by the end user itself, the business owner or the CXOs who are looking at these reports, they can do a self-service BI themselves. Now, looking at this kind of requirement and keeping the scenario in mind, this is our Power BI environment. As part of Power BI environment, you have number of sample data over here. You can check for it. So what are the samples available? If you already have your own content, you can pull your content from Excel file, your SharePoint resources, SQL Server resources. Now again, behind the scene, it will connect to them using respective connectors, right? Once you have used these connectors, specify the value that you would want. What is the SQL Server name to establish the connection that you would want to do with your content? Now, once that content is being received over here, once the content is being received over here, so you'll be able to see your information. Right? You'll be able to see your information over here. Now in my case, this is what I have created using a sample data store. So what is the gross margin that you'd want? I can dig deeper into it by going to respective reports over here. I can modify these reports, specify whatever filter parameters I want. So you all will be able to see these information over here on the right hand side. Okay, which months you want to mention over here, which regions you want to mention over here. So once it comes to your resources within Power BI or any kind of business analytics when you're doing, you'll always have two members over here. One is the facts that you have, right? And second one that you will have over here is your dimensions. Right? So let me give an example over here. So as far as the fact is concerned, the fact over here will be, say a company has earned 10 crore for 10 crore, right? Now, what is it relevant for a business owner? For a business owner, it's actually making no sense. So what they would do is they would say, can you please provide this information in terms of dimensions? Now, what will be these dimensions? These dimensions will be, can you please tell me this is part of which financial year? Is it the total worth of the company that you are telling me? Or is it the earning of that organization that you are telling me? Or is it the profit that you are telling me? What is it? If it is profit or if it is earnings, it is again not sufficient. You have to tell me, how did I earn this revenue? By going ahead with which services or which particular products, right? Where did I earn more? In which set of services, and in which set of services I did not earn the amount of investment which was being done. So now what we are looking at is ROI. What is the return on investment that we had from a business perspective? This is what an organization would want to know about. Second is, can you be more precise in terms of timelines, right? So in terms of dimensions, you have a time series database. You'll have a time series database, and using this time series database, you'll be able to get details in terms of daily information, daily earnings, weekly earnings, quarterly earnings, right? Yearly earnings. This is what is part of your time series database. And as part of your dimensions, now what we can do is, you can break up these things into respective time dimensions. Can you see this? So when we are talking about filters, these filters are nothing but dimensions that we are mentioning for the value that we have shown. And this is the core purpose of Power BI, helping the end users understand what is the focus area for them, which sector they want to break it up into. Can you see this? Industry-wise, pharma sector. So one organization could be providing number of services. So service-wise, if I want to see how was the growth or was there a degrowth that we had, product-wise, I want a particular information, right? So I can get those details over here. Right? So under telecom sector, whatever are the relevant products, you'll be able to get that information here. So 10 crore may be a big number, but 10 crore will make sense only if it is being organized correctly in terms of dimensions. Okay. I'm not sure if it is making sense for you all, but I would recommend once it comes to Power BI, start looking at some of the Power BI reports, right? What are the components over here in terms of dashboards, in terms of respective workspaces? But before that, you need to have a right data which you feed in. And once you have mentioned this information, once you have mentioned this data, you'll be able to create respective reports over here. You also have licensing for Power BI, and as part of your Power BI licensing, it will help you to customize these resources, customize the reports that you have. Similar to your Power Automate, you have Power BI Desktop as an option, which can help you integrate with your on-premises environment. And like how I showed you a complete tool, you also have a tool for your on-premises environment. That is part of your Power BI desktop. So even if you have resources within your local on-premises SQL database, how do I pull that value and how do I showcase it to the end user? Even those things can be done over here. One more thing, which I'm not sure if everybody is aware about, even if you have streaming information or live information, because earlier what was happening is SSRS was only focusing on older data, that is, online analytical processing, OLAP data sources. As far as Power BI is concerned, Power BI, you can also work with streaming information, live information, right? That will be the core advantage of using Power BI resources. again, there was a very important conversation. I'm not sure who, I forgot the name, my mistake. There are a number of products that you have for RPA. Similarly, you have a number of products that you have for workflows as well. I mentioned names for some of them. Similarly, you also have number of other reporting tools. You have QlikView, QlikSense, you have Tableau, right? As compared to Tableau, QlikView, you may not have all the features which is available there. But one thing that you need to understand is, it is part of, it is not an independent solution. It is part of entire series of resource. And as an end user, when you're looking at an end-to-end solution, right? When you're looking at as an end-to-end solution, in those scenarios, just one tool may not be helpful for you. You need all the necessary components with respective background, with respective resource, which can help you pull that data and work with those members, right? That would be my suggestion. Still, I leave that decision to y'all as a business decision makers, right? As a part of a team, what is the kind of data that you have? What is the kind of restrictions that you can look at for a, look for a workaround and work with them? Or what kind of restrictions or compliance related concerns or data storage size that you're looking at? If it is not solved by a given tool, you may not want to go for it.
So, yes. This is Shailesh. Yes, may I ask?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, so like, you know, currently in our organization, we have multiple Power BI dashboards, right? So okay. I wanted to see if we could develop a solution where, you know, today if we had to look at any of these values, right? We have to always go to these dashboards and check for, you know, a particular tile and let's say sales figure for the month of June for one particular product, right? So you have to open the dashboard, click on the relevant reports and then go and look at the value. I was thinking like if we could create, is there a possibility to create in Power Automate something which will, you know, whenever a value changes, you know, it can just send up a pop-up message or a chatbot sort of thing where, you know, it will integrate with these Power BI tiles and bring those values directly whenever there are changes.
From whatever knowledge I have, I can trigger a Power trigger a Power Automate based on a change of the data. But as far as the Power BI is concerned, I don't know if there is a direct action available as of now. But if there is a data change, yes, data change within SQL or any other data source, I can trigger a Power Automate. That's possible.
Yeah, because on Power BI, you know, you have those measures and you know, created measures, which actually is not available in backend, right? So some values, some price values are there on the Power BI tiles, but not in the backend.
So why don't you go for live options for Power BI? So the moment that data changes over there, it will automatically refresh on the Power BI dashboard. Wouldn't that work for you?
No. So I agree. Power BI, I want you know, to remove the effort that is required to go to open a Power BI dashboard, look at that value, right? I just want, like, you know, an automated Teams chat message that comes in which says, hey, this sales figure has changed to this, something like that.
I think definitely this should be possible. I'll have to check for the exact implementation for it. This should be doable.
Sorry to interrupt, but I think with Flow Intimate Mail, we can control these things.
Sorry, once again.
By using alert from the Flow, we can get exactly what the things get updated in our Outlook box. This is possible, I think.
Outlook, Shailesh, you are looking from Outlook perspective or Teams, you are saying, right? Teams chat window.
Teams chat window.
So Teams integration is there as far as Power Automate is concerned.
Team integration is also.
But it is there only in the Power Automate, correct? No.
Yes, I'm talking about Power Automate.
Yeah.
I'm not saying BI, I'm saying from Power Automate, any change in the data source, I can send it to a Teams integration. That's possible.
Right.
Just to share, I mean, one of our requirements, we found that using Power Automate, we can refresh the data set. Okay, we can do some kind of scheduling, or if you place a button and click off it, the flow will trigger and that can refresh the data set of the Power BI report.
Great input. Thank you very much, guys. Let's move to the next one. So in terms of Power BI, you have a complete learning path and you have respective documentation for this as well, like I showed for the earlier members. Let's go to the next resource over here, which is part of your Power platform. The next important member over here, which I mentioned earlier, is from a chatbot perspective. Now, as part of your chatbot, this is again a UI that we are mentioning about. Behind the scene, you still have to go ahead, train this model if you want to handle a lot of complex queries. In terms of creation of these resources, I can create these resources by using a bot option over here, using a Power Virtual Agent. So in this Power Virtual Agent, what you can do is we can create our questions saying that these are the conditions, these are the options, right? This is how I want to enable user interactions. So based on the values given by the user, based on the selections done by the user, how do I perform the next set of steps for it? Right? Now that is what is one of the most critical aspects of Power Virtual Agents. Like I mentioned earlier, initially when we were looking at creation of bots, we'll have to run through number of technologies, number of options for .NET, Java, OSS, right? And then we were able to create these bots. Apart from this, you need to have something like Microsoft Cognitive Services, right? Where you have to train this model separately. Now, all these things has come into a simplified environment by using Power Virtual Agents. In terms of Power Virtual Agents, you have web.powerva.microsoft.com. Now, each of these services that you see, these are independent services like flow.microsoft.com, make.powerapps.com, right? Similarly, for Power Virtual Agents, you have web.powerva.microsoft.com. Now, if you see the entire dev test scenario over here, I have taken a Synergetics bot over here. I can specify topics which I want. You have complete series of documentation for this as well. So if you want to look at the licensing options. So this is part of your Microsoft 365 subscription. And you also have a separate subscription for it, which is Power Virtual Agent subscription. So depending upon what kind of environment that you are looking for, what are the options that you want to set up over here, you can do that. Going back to our Power Virtual Agent, if you already have a online content, PDF file, Word document or CSV file, you can associate that over here. Or you can directly go ahead, check for set of existing options. Let me add a trigger phase over here, which is Power Platform. Let me go to the authoring canvas. Let me go to authoring canvas. Now within authoring canvas, you can specify what is the trigger phase that you would want, right? What is the message you want to show to the user, right? And how do you want to do the required conversation over here, right? So these are set of key components that you'll have within your specific topic. Let me take up a new topic over here. Let me mention a trigger phase as Power Platform. Whatever values you want to mention over here, let me go to the authoring canvas. Now on this authoring canvas, I can specify the entire flow over here. The trigger phase is Power Platform. Let me specify questions over here. So what is the message that you want to display over here? And what we are doing is we are building the entire conversation with the user. So whether you want to show him a message, something like what Manish and team would do is they would go ahead, show up a message over here. So the moment somebody types Power Platform, welcome to Synergetics, learn Power Platform. After showing a message, ask a question. Now, what is the question that you want to ask? Some of the prerequisites that one would want to check, we can do here. Sorry. What kind of questions you want to ask? City, color, continent, duration, email. So there are a lot of pre-built questions over here. Can you please tell me what is your name, phone number, right? So pre-sales perspective, sales perspective, right? Even if the user wants to mention their information, all that details can be provided from here. So what is the option that you have? So if I'm asking a simple question, do you have a background in Office 365? Yes or no? Mention those values over here. If yes, ask another question. Which topic you want to go for? So whether you want to go for Power Apps, whether you want to go for Power Automate, you want to go for Power Platform. You see that? The moment I keep adding the options, I get more and more branches over here.
So how do we run our custom code through that flow?
I didn't get you, sorry.
Means if I have my own code for let's say I have a means PowerShell script that I want the flow to run, how do we edit?
This is not a flow, it's a bot.
Yeah, so if I want my bot to run a script which is means custom made and I've stored it within on-prem or on cloud, how to connect it?
I don't think it will connect to it.
Okay.
As far as bot is concerned, bot basically is helping, it can help you connect to Power Automate. Power Automate will connect to your script.
Okay, okay.
That way, bots are not supposed to execute any code directly. This will help you connect to your existing resources. This is more a question answer kind of thing that you have. And if you go for any bots that you have created, they don't execute a script directly. They will trigger another member. And that new member being triggered, that will perform the required action to it.
In case if you want to have our custom database or something like have my own list of questions, answers.
Yes.
How to integrate that here?
That's already I mentioned, remember? Uploading a Word document, uploading a PDF. So that will be giving your entities. Now, once you have those entities, then you go and create your virtual agent here.
So here itself we can upload? Sorry, Om Prakash, your voice is not audible. Hello.
Om Prakash.
Om Prakash, we can't hear you, Om Prakash.
Yeah, we can't hear you. I think he has some connectivity issue.
Yeah.
Hello, am I audible to you all?
Yeah, bro.
Yes.
What I was saying is, when you are creating a topic, while creating a topic itself, I showed you this option that how do you get values from a PDF or any other member. Now, if you want to go to the next level, that is specifying your own data source, training a model, right? Those things you can do using an AI builder. In bot, you can't do that. Bot basically is more like a UI for interaction. If you want to create a database behind the scene, you need to go to AI builder. Am I making sense?
So Om Prakash, so for using the AI builder, we can capture the data and we can analyze that data, kind of survey, correct? Okay, but we need to use AI builder for that.
Wait, I'll put that process once again. As far as AI builder is concerned, AI builder is something which is based on machine learning solutions, which will help you train your model. After you have trained your model, then you go and put information. It will analyze that information, get the matching details and revert back to you. That is how it happens.
But when you say train, is there any specific mechanism or methods that we need to use?
Absolutely right. You have to do that. And that's what machine learning is all about. That's what artificial intelligence is all about. You'll have to train your model by giving relevant data.
Okay.
So after you have trained your model, you associate that model here. That if this is the kind of input, this is the kind of response that you should get. This is the kind of response you should give.
Okay. So maybe, I mean, I'm not sure it's out of scope, but if you forever, please help me to understand. So we are building something like that, and we have around 250 questions. Okay, 250 questions and their answers.
Yes.
But when we start, start training the bot, then that
we
time,
don't
I mean,
train the bot. Again, I'll correct that. We don't train the bot. We train a model.
Right.
Using AI builder. Yes.
In fact, we are using the Q&A maker service.
Correct.
So while doing so, I mean, my question, do we need to train all those 250 questions? I mean, it's like a very cumbersome task to question each question, request for each question and train the response. Is there any mechanism that will speed up the process to train it?
Okay, that's absolutely valid. So in that cases, you'll have to go for Azure Cognitive Services. Within Azure Cognitive Services, you have a Q&A maker. You just upload your questions and answers over there, train your model, and then use that as a service with your bot.
I think still there we need to do the training.
There is no option apart from training. Whether you have a small data set or large data set, you have to train a model.
Oh, okay.
There is no shortcut to it. If you want, see, what you are trying to do is you are trying to put a human intelligence inside a robot, right?
Yeah.
Without training, the robot will not be as efficient as a human being.
Okay.
So the only option is training. And you train the model or you train that bot with the right kind of data set. That's important.
Yeah, that will give more accuracy in this.
Absolutely correct. Yeah. Absolutely correct. That will give you more accuracy.
Hi, Om Prakash. It's Taufik here. I wanted to know that if I want to, you know, bring some changes in the questions for the chatbot. So where the changes I have to do?
In the data set.
In the data set?
Yes.
Okay.
That
so,
data set is the owner of the entire entire content.
Okay. Okay. So, no changes can be done in the test bot section, right? It's the chat bot section.
Test bot has nothing to do with it. Or as far as chat bot is concerned, okay, let me put this once again. Chat bot is like a web application.
Okay.
It does not take up the complete page. It takes a bottom left hand side or right hand side corner for you. But it is actually a web application. Whatever you want to do, make it do. You have to write inside the UI how that panel should be displayed, what kind of controls will be displayed in the chatbot. But as far as the background thing is concerned, the processing is concerned, that's done by the AI builder. It's not done by chatbot. So there is some process, like if you look at a web application, you click on a button or you click on particular web entity, it goes and invokes a service layer behind it. Am I right? It will invoke a component behind the scene which is written in .NET or Java or some programming language. Same thing holds true for chatbot as well.
Understood.
Chatbot is just a front-ending component.
Prakash, sorry, again, maybe it might be out of scope, but if you are aware, please help me to understand. We came across Azure Bot Framework and here we have our virtual agent. And when we compared the licenses, Azure Bot Framework was very less. I mean, it's very less costly and comparatively Power Virtual Agent is very costly. So we were trying to understand why, I mean, what is the advantages we have here when compared with Azure Bots, Bot Framework and the Power Virtual Agent.
Absolutely correct. So I'm not sure why the price is higher, but from my understanding, I'll let you know. From my understanding, the kind of simplicity Power Virtual Agent gives you and the kind of programming dependency which is being reduced over here, that could be the reason why the cost is higher. And that's what I'm telling based on my understanding. I have worked with both these services. I find working with Power Virtual Agents much more simpler as compared to how you can work with cognitive services. Cognitive services, you cannot work without a... Cognitive services, you need to have a programming API there. Without programming API, you can't work with it. So I think that could be one of the reasons why the cost is higher.
Okay. Because, I mean, the cost is very, I mean, too much. I mean, it's uncomparable, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah, I mean, we also thought the same thing, but we thought, like, there could be some benefits, additional benefits, which we are not aware of.
Just one moment. Huh? Let me complete this.
Sure. And somebody, I mean, who has asked earlier, I just want to share one use case.
Sure. Go ahead.
One of our team has, not our team, basically from PTG team, they have developed one POC.
Mm-hmm.
They designed the Power Virtual Agent. And in the back end, they are invoking the Power Automate, which is connecting to ServiceNow. So what's happening is, when you type in a invoice number in the Power Virtual Agent, that will read the data from ServiceNow and show it on the chart window. How it is happening is, behind the design, when you type in the question or invoice number, that is passed to the Power Automate. The Power Automate is using the ServiceNow API. It is passing this invoice ID to the ServiceNow API.
and ServiceNow API is returning the value which is been shown on the chatbot or chat window. That's one use case one of our PDG team has done.
Thank you for the update. That really helps, because believe me guys, there are a lot of current implementations which has been done by using Power Automate, by using the resources that we have over here, right? And integration of Power Automate with Power Apps, like rightly said, there are number of implementations that you'll see for it. Right. So here, if you see the execution, welcome to Synergetics, learn Power Platform. Do you have a background on Office 365? Yes. Which topic do you want to learn? Power Apps, Power Automate, Power Platform. So depending upon whatever choice you have made, it will answer those questions and end with a feedback. So once we're done with this, we can go ahead, publish this environment. And once you have published it, you'll be able to access it from any other resource, whether it is your Teams or Facebook or Slack or Skype, right? You'll be able to access these resources from anywhere. You can also add it as part of your web page over here, like I was mentioning about. So behave it as a, make it as a UI component. Now, there was a lot of questions in terms of AI builder. And I already mentioned, you can go to your models section. Within models section, you can build your own model. Okay. Now here, even if you see these options, business card reader, category classification, your key phrase detection, so you can initiate this by using a flow. You can initiate this by using an app in a Power App environment or a Power Automate environment. Now here what we are supposed to do is, here we are supposed to train this model. Sorry, I went to a wrong place. Can you see the option here? There should be 10 example sentences. So if you're dealing with text based inputs, test based questions answers, there should be 10 example sentences over here, which will help you train your model. Can you see this? So what is the kind of details that you are mentioning? So once you are training your model, you have to map it to respective UI attribute. You have to mention, map it to the respective attributes over here. Email attribute, state, organization. This is what you mean by training a model. So first thing is creating a particular model, training the model by giving appropriate data. And once you have given that appropriate data, whoever was mentioning about training it using cognitive services, you see these steps are same in both the places. But if you look at the large scale kind of implementation, the number of users are huge. And this can be, this is going beyond the organization. You are interacting with outside team members. In those cases, it is recommended to go for a Azure Cognitive Services. Whereas if you're looking at from an organization perspective, that's where you should go for your AI builder, train this model in a smaller context, for that business and work with it. So from where are you getting this information? So I have my Dataverse entities over here. I can get information from there. Account number, account name. It says right now there's no data. So I have to pull this data from the relevant data store. Okay, so I'll stop here. This was a quick look in terms of the Power Platform. Anyone, any questions you all have? Please go ahead with your questions now.
Hi, Omkar. What are the different certifications required for Power Platform?
Superb question. Just give me a minute. As far as our platform is concerned, these are set of certifications that you have on Power Platform. The first one is Power Platform Fundamentals, PL900. Second one that you have is PL100. I'm not sure if this is still there because most of the things are common between PL100 and PL200. So I would recommend go for PL200. Then you have PL300 as well from an architecting perspective. PL200 is functional analyst. PL100 is Power Platform Maker. And PL300 is Power Platform Architecting. These are four certifications that you have with Power Platform. And as part of Microsoft, we help participants clear all these certifications. Platform Maker, this is Functional Consultant. Then you have PL300, which is an architect. Yeah, anyone else? Any other questions?
Hello, Om Prakash. Kunal here.
Yes.
So I have one query related to chatbot. So
let's say
I have more than one chatbot in my environment. So is there any way or mechanism that from one chatbot we can instantiate to another? Like in one chatbot, we have a mechanism to switch between topics. But is there any way that we can switch between chatbots directly?
That as well. So I am not sure if you noticed it. If I go to Power Platform, go to the authoring canvas.
Yes. So here we can see, we have provision that we can switch to topic. But this is something related to same topic, right? In the same chat. No.
As far as these topics are concerned, these topics will initiate another set of question answer conversation that you have.
But in the same chatbot, right? In the same bot.
In the same chatbot, yes.
Yeah, so let's say chatbot
is again the UI environment, right? You'll not go from one UI to second UI. You'll remain in the same UI, but now the set of question answers will change.
Yes. But let's say, what if I do have more than one chatbot in my environment? So is there any mechanism that we can instantiate?
There's no mechanism.
Okay. Thank you.
Because see, these are based on single page application, right?
Yes.
Everything will be within that same chatbot. You say, I don't have this question. I have another question. So now what is your question? Based on that, it will jump from topic to topic.
Topic to topic.
But in the same bot, you'll see all the conversation.
Yes. Got it. Clear. Thank you.
So for example, I have one flow in Power Automate desktop version and I want that to be used by third person. So that third person need to install desktop version, or we can create executable file and we can share with them.
Great question, but Mohit, see how it happens is, as far as Power Automate desktop is concerned, Power Automate desktop will run on the machine where you have where the Power Automate desktop is installed. Are you getting it?
Yes.
You can invoke it from outside. You can invoke that member from outside. You can do that. But it will run in the environment where the gateway is being installed and your Power Automate desktop is being installed.
Okay.
Generally, what people do is they run a create a server kind of environment, and on that environment, they install all these components.
Okay.
So if the second machine is part of the network, you can go and initiate that machine, install components on that machine, all those things you can do.
Okay.
So that's part of RPA, I mean, desktop,
yes.
Power Automate. So as you said, like, I mean, we need to have a production server wherein the desktop has to be installed.
Yes. Where the actual execution will happen.
Okay, so while developing, we heard, like, I mean, we need to, when the flow runs, we should not do any activity in the server. So what happens? I mean, is it is it expected same in the production server as well?
See, once it comes to, first of all, when you see production server, what is the purpose of that server? You have to define that. If the purpose of that server is integration, that's where you'll have your Power Virtual Agent being installed, Power Virtual Desktop Agent being installed, and it will be running there.
Right.
If you look at BizTalk server or any other integration server, that's actually a production server, but on that production server is meant to do integration, meant to run integration workflows.
Okay.
So this is the kind of server that you are building, where you are installing this agent. That is our virtual, sorry, your
desktop. Okay. So my question was, like, I mean, do we, if somebody is deploying something else other than, for example, while the flow executes,
correct,
is there any problem?
My experience, I don't think there should be any problem. It might take slightly longer because the same process, processor is being consumed there, but it will not be a problem.
Okay. And do we need the gateway to be installed on the server?
Gateways need to be installed if you are working or extracting some data from that. Say, for example, something is being installed on that machine and you want to extract some data, then the gateway is required. Otherwise, the gateway is not required.
Oh, okay. 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 So you mean to say I can develop a Power Automate desktop flow and
yes,
host on a production server, then it will run automatically. I mean, as per the process, it will execute. But
right,
if I want to connect to, for example, if I invoke the UI flow from cloud Power Automate, then I need the gateway installed in the server, on the server.
That's right.
Okay. Okay. Got it. Thank you.
Yeah, Om Prakash.
MS Forms. I don't know whether it is in scope or not. Can we customize MS Forms?
No, you cannot. And that's not part of Power Platform as well. MS Form is more like Google Forms.
Okay.
You cannot customize that. It will have set of pre-existing components. If you want to customize, you'll have to go to Power Apps. That's where you can customize and create your own kind of forms and allow the people within your organization to access it.
And in Power Apps, we can do customization to a greater extent, like whatever you want.
Yes, that's right.
Thank you.
Is there a way
Sorry, 1 minute. Somebody else is asking a question.
Yeah.
Please
go ahead. Om Prakash. Is there a way to trigger Power Automate desktop process in a schedule basis? You showed that we can do it through a Power Automate web application, but is it a possible scenario from desktop application?
I didn't get you. You are saying,
so
I want
to
put a flow within Power
if
Automate
we have
on the web.
Yes, we have prepared a process flow in Power Desktop application. So how can we trigger that flow using a schedule basis?
I think that is possible. So here, if I go to scheduled cloud flow, I can invoke a desktop flow from here.
Okay, so this action seems to be a premium action. So is there any license requirement for that, or it's free and available? If yes, then what license is required?
It's free and available. You can use it. You can specify your your desktop details over here, and you should be able to work it, work with it.
Hi, Om Prakash. This is Kapil here. Is it possible to create an app like offline, which will work in offline mode? Yes. In some places there is low connectivity or.
You say offline mode. What do you mean by that?
If a user put its input in application, and it will get synchronized when he will in the network, like that.
So okay, let me ask another question. So when you are triggering the flow, is the user in network? When the trigger happens.
No, nothing.
No, then it will not work. See, okay. At least when the triggering is happening, the user should be in network. Once that workflow starts executing, it will execute on the online environment. User need not be connected to it. So once
user just want to input his.
Once the entire process is complete, it will update the data store or update whatever values you want, send an email to the user. And once user is back in network, he can see that this process has complete. But for triggering, he has to be in network. Starting network.
If we skip that triggering part, then just user want to put some input
then user has to do nothing. Skipping an input, which you are saying it's a scheduled flow. Okay. Scheduled flow means user has no role to play there. So whenever the time is there, whatever mapping you have done, on that schedule it will automatically execute. No user input is required.
Okay, is there any possibility that user will save data in Dataverse and then it will synchronize in our main database?
That's done. That can be done.
Okay.
But it's not required actually.
Yeah.
Dataverse is more to do with the schema. If you have connectivity with the database directly, push it to the database directly, no problem.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Why would you want to store that in Dataverse?
Yeah, got it. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, guys. Let's stop here. I hope everybody has got set of details to start with as far as the Power Platform is concerned. So I hand it over to Manish and team.
Yes, thank you so much, Om Prakash sir, for this wonderful session on the complete guide to MS Power Platform. Also, thank you everyone for joining today's webinar. I request you everyone just be available for 5 minutes. I'll be real quick. So I hope my screen is visible to all. Okay. So this is our next webinar series calendar. Okay. Which I've already displayed to you at the start of the session. And these are the two upcoming webinars that are going to happen in the next weekend. So the time is mentioned here. One is starting at 10 a.m. The other will be at 2 p.m. The one is for emerging technology. Another webinar is for DP100 certification. So your feedbacks are very important to us. So here, once we receive the feedback, out of those feedback, we are going to select 5 attendees. And they are going to get the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers. 5 lucky winners are going to get that. So please do share your feedback. The form link is already given in the chat box. Again, after this, I'm going to share it. Another special announcement. So now you can easily and smartly boost your career. Simply update your Microsoft skills and certifications on LinkedIn and showcase your talent to other professionals who belongs to relevant technology. So here is a special campaign that has been conducted by Microsoft, where once after this session, you can update your skills by going to your LinkedIn profile. I assume that everyone is having their LinkedIn account. And once you update your skills, there's a form. You just have to fill that. The form link, that link is given in the feedback form. At the end, you can check that. Once the skill or your badge or like certification that has been updated, you can just fill that. Okay, so you can follow us on the social medias, and this recording for the session will be uploaded on a YouTube channel, so do subscribe to it And you will be notified with the uploads, videos and session recordings over there. So thank you so much once again for being here. We'll meet in the next session and have a great weekend, everyone. Thank you so much.
Manish or Rupesh, sorry, one question. Yeah. Question. Yeah. Regarding certification, are you guys supporting writing the exam and taking care of everything with respect to preparation and getting the certificate?
Yeah, basically, the package that we offer here is like you get a training MOC for the preparation of the exam and the exam voucher. This is the package that you're going to get once you enroll with us. So obviously during the training you will get the proper assistance from our trainers, and preparation will help you, with the MOC you will get an idea for the preparation before attending an examination. So examination you have to give online on the Microsoft side.
And also please follow our YouTube channel. On our YouTube channel there is one webinar called online certification test. Okay, how you can appear for prepare for online test. Okay, so you can we will share the link in the chat box later for that.
Sure, yeah. And I would request you to please share anything related to Power Platform certification 200, 300 or 900 or 100. Any material from your side that you can allow to share with us?
Sure. Okay. Please mention in your feedback form so we can directly contact with you.
Okay. Okay. Sure. Thanks.